Joshua chapter 3, verse 5. And Joshua said unto the people, Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. Ladies and gentlemen, the Spirit of the Lord told me to talk to you and just to tell you to sanctify yourselves. You know what time it is. Let's get it.
Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me?
Accepting the fact that my goal is the top, then knowing heaven is in that spot keeps driving me nonstop. Never allowing hell to defeat me. It's not possible as long as it's beneath me. Nothing sent from there could ever reach.
What's going on, ladies and gentlemen? This is Apostle Makhario coming to you all again. And the Spirit of the Lord just spoke to me, just placed in my heart to give you all this message. I was actually studying this earlier today, and that was Joshua chapter 3. But it is it seems very simple, but the thing about it is it's so powerful. And this is what Joshua told the people. In Joshua chapter 3, verse 5, it says, And Joshua said unto the people, Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. I want you all to understand and get just how important it is that you sanctify yourself. Sanctification means you purify yourself. You do what you can to live holy for God, and you begin to live holy for God. That way God can do those wonders among you. But I'm going to just take you here really quickly. There are a couple things I just want you to see and how this ties in to Joshua chapter 3, verse 5. And Joshua said unto the people, Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. So really quickly, we will turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2. Verses 19 through 21, because I want you all to get this. It says, Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his. Knoweth. I keep telling you all about this know thing. God wants you to know him. Knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Remember, I taught you and I told you, iniquity is hidden sin in the heart. Verse 20. But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Ladies and gentlemen, the Spirit of the Lord wants you to sanctify yourself. For tomorrow the Lord will do great wonders among you. But in order for the Lord to do great wonders among you, you must be, you got it, sanctified. And that's what it says here in verse 21. But I want you to take a look at verse 20. It says, But in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. You have to understand, God's house, the kingdom of God, the body of Christ, the kingdom of heaven, that is a great house. And there are some vessels that are worth honoring and some vessels that get dishonored because they have not sanctified themselves. That's why it says in verse 21, if a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. So when you sanctify yourself, it says that you become a vessel of honor. It says you're meet for the master's use, which means God can download, speak to you, give you things that he wants you to give to others and for you to receive, to teach and to reach for his kingdom, and prepared unto every good work, which means God, once you're sanctified, will not allow you to have to go out unprepared or to be made ashamed. I want you all to get this. You will not go out unprepared to do the work of the Lord. I love you, Jesus. Let's go one more place because I just want you all to go know this. This was a really quick video, and there's so much more I could give you concerning this, even down to 2 Timothy chapter 2, which we're already there. Verse 15, it says, Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So when you go out, you study study to show yourself approved unto God, you're a workman for God, and you don't need to be ashamed, and you're rightly dividing the word of truth. So you don't have to be ashamed because you've already sanctified yourself, and the Lord already has you prepared unto every good work. Come on, somebody. I love you, Jesus. Just really quickly, taking you here, because I want you all to understand that sanctification, being purified, purged, holy, made righteous in God's sight, comes with fasting and studying, right? Studying, fasting, and praying. And I teach you all about that all the time, how important it is for you to study, fast, and pray. Sanctification is huge. And the way that you can be sanctified, the way that you can live holy before God, is to study, fast, and pray. But let's go here, because I want you to see a great example of what it means to be sanctified before God. So this is Acts chapter 9. This is talking about Saul when he was knocked off of his horse, when he spoke with Jesus. But it says here, we'll just start at verse 8. It says, "And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man, but they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus." Verse 9 is key. It says, "And he was 3 days without sight, and neither did eat nor drink," which means he was fasting without sight. And if you continue, it says here that the Lord spoke to Ananias. So if you continue here, it says in Acts chapter 9, verse 10 and 11, it says, "And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayeth." So you all see how these things happen. Now, Saul already knew the word of God. He was already persecuting Christians, thinking he was doing the work of God. But once he came into contact with Jesus, after Jesus knocked him off the horse in a vision, and he went blind, in verse 9 it says, "In 3 days he was without sight, and neither did eat nor drink," right? In verse 11 it says that the Lord spoke to Ananias, "And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayeth." So he was fasting and praying. You understand? After he came into contact with Jesus, thinking he was doing the work of God and persecuting Christians and killing them or having them killed, he thought he was doing the work of God. He ran into Jesus, got knocked off his horse, went blind, went to a house, did not eat nor drink while he was blind. And Jesus told Ananias, he also prayeth. So he was fasting and praying, and he already knew the word. But here's the key, because it ties into what I just gave you in 2 Timothy chapter 2. If you go down in Acts chapter 9, you go down to verse 19 through 22, this is what it says. "And when he had received meat," this is after Ananias came and prayed, laid hands on him, the scales fell from his eyes, he received his sight again. And it says, "And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogue, that he is the Son of God. But all that heard him were amazed and said, Is not this he that destroyed them which called on the name of on this name in Jerusalem, and came hither for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priest? But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ." Look at what happened. God allowed him, through Jesus Christ, to see a vision, get knocked off his horse. He began to sanctify himself. He prayed. He was without sight 3 days, neither did eat nor drink. So he was fasting, and he was praying in verse 11. Once he received his sight and received meat in verses 19 through 22, it says in verse 22, "But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ." Ladies and gentlemen, what does the scripture say? Joshua told them in Joshua chapter 3, verse 5, And Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do great, will do wonders among you. Will do wonders among you. And then in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21, it says, if a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. If you understand what happened to Saul, which became the apostle Paul, then you'll understand that through sanctification, he was meet and prepared for the use of the master unto every good work. And we see that not only did God use him to do great miracle signs and wonders against those to which he was once attached, against those that persecuted Jesus the Christ and the Christian church, but God also used him to write majority of the New Testament that we know, at least more than half of the New Testament Paul, the Apostle Paul, wrote. So you have to understand, ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you this because the Spirit of the Lord dropped it in me. It's relatively late at night. It's probably 11 o'clock right now, or a little bit after 11. But it says, and it's not that I couldn't do it earlier. I was ministering and teaching someone the gospel. But it says here in Joshua chapter 3, verse 5, it says, and Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. Once Paul, after he encountered Jesus the Christ, decided to sanctify himself through fasting and prayer, God did wonders among him. But it wasn't that day. It was 3 days later. So it was on tomorrow. On tomorrow. So what you, the work that you, I love you, Jesus. The work that you put in today will show up for you tomorrow. One last place. I want to leave you with the words of Jesus again. I got to do this. I wasn't going to go again. The Holy Spirit is just giving me all of these things. I'm going to take you here one more time, though. Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, verse 6. Actually, start at verse 5. Jesus said this. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward, because all they want to do is be seen. Verse 6, but thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which is in secret shall reward thee openly. Pray in secret, and God will reward you openly. See, Ananias and none of the other Jews would have known that Paul was praying, Saul at the time, that Saul was praying. But because God revealed the heart of Saul to Ananias, which I taught you all about that, when they say nobody knows what's in a person's heart, that's a lie, because God knows. He will reveal it to his people, his prophets, the ones that he wants to use, the ones that are sanctified. He revealed it to Ananias. Ananias knew that Saul was in prayer. What Ananias didn't know is Saul was also fasting and praying. Ha, come on, Jesus. And Saul did it in secret. He prayeth. I'm sure the people didn't hear him praying after his vision. Nobody knew why he was sitting there for 3 days. Maybe people knew that he was blind, but nobody knew why he was sitting there for 3 days, why he wasn't eating. He didn't make it a spectacle for people to know. He did it before God. And once he did it before God, what happened? What did Jesus say? And the Lord shall reward you openly when you go into your closet and pray. See, people think if they don't hear you praying, that you're not seeking God's face. They should hear you tarrying and praying out loud. That's a lie. That's not scriptural. Every once in a while, the Lord will have you pray out loud. Absolutely. But when you pray, and you pray in the spirit, and you pray before God, and it's a heartfelt prayer, the Lord shall reward you openly. God shall manifest his glory through you in the open. Then all men will know that you're connected to God. Sanctify yourselves. I love you all. I will see you all again soon. May God bless. We are out.
Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me.
How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Accepting the fact that my goal is the top, then knowing heaven is in that spot keeps driving me nonstop. Never allowing hell to defeat me. It's not possible as long as it's beneath me. Nothing sent from there could ever.